Good afternoon and welcome to the dermatology department's combined round. Now, you must have heard many of the faculty saying at different times that one of the rewards of working here is the chance to interact with and to learn from younger minds. We are going to give you a concrete example of that today. Now, for many years, off and on, we had been seeing a facial eruption, localized facial eruption. And I clearly remember discussing it with some of my faculty colleagues, and we were not able to figure out what is happening. And we couldn't come to a conclusion till it was sorted out for us by our residents. So Dr. Akash will present the index case, and then Dr. Tanvi will describe the process of unraveling the problem. And she will also present a brief pictorial review of some related skin conditions. And then we'll take your questions and comments, in-person questions, as well as questions on YouTube. Anybody who has a question can put his question in the chat box, and we'll take a look at those questions too at the end of the presentation. So I'll now invite Dr. Akash to kick things off.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the combined clinical rounds of facial rash due to the prolonged thinking. Today, I'll be presenting a case of 59-year-old gentleman of total disease duration in the last 20 years who presented to us with chief complaint of insidious onset keratotic papules with surrounding hyperpigmentation over the left mandibular area. He consulted multiple dermatologists and he received non-specific treatment without any much improvement. Here we can see that multiple follicular keratotic papule on the background of hyperpigmentation. With this presentation, we had a clinical differential of keratosis pilaris, lichen spinulosus, and trichostasis spinulosa. Keratosis pilaris usually occur in the females in adolescent age group, usually present as gradual onset follicular keratotic papules mainly on the extents of the arm and thigh, and is associated with perifollicular erythema, usually precipitated by rubbing on clothing and usually persists for a longer time before resolution. There is a variant of keratosis pilaris which occur on the face, that is erythromelanosis follicularis facii et coli. It presents as keratotic papule on the cheeks and neck with surrounding erythema. Lichen spinulosus commonly occur in the children and young adults, which presents as sudden onset symmetrical follicular keratotic papule mainly on the extensor aspect of the limbs and trunk, and it has pointed keratotic spine, we can see in the picture. And it usually spares the face, hands and feet, and usually persists for many years. Trichostasis spinulosa commonly occurs in the middle-aged to elderly female. It is due to the retention of the numerous vellus hairs and cartilage teeth in the dilated follicle. It presents as comedone-like lesion over the nose, forehead and cheek. It is associated with usage of topical steroids and minoxidil. On further inquiry, we found that patient used to spend a lot of his daily time on this posture, that is resting his chin on the palm. This is a famous picture, this is the thinker statue. This was sculptured by August Rodin. And here you can see that a man thinking on a bench with thinking deeply while resting his chin against his hand. The patient was a professor in the Delhi University and used to spend around 7 to 8 hours per day on this posture while reading books and watching television. And he readily accepted the possible association of the development of the lesion with the posture when suggested by us. And we counseled him regarding the course of the disease with his posture, and we advised him to avoid this posture, and we asked him to use tretinoin cream locally at night. The patient stopped tretinoin cream after 2 weeks and he strictly avoided the posture, and after 6 months we can see that significant improvement in the keratotic papule as well as the hyperpigmentation, and patient reported around 65 to 70% improvement in the lesions, and patient was happy. With this, we finally made the diagnosis of pressure-induced follicular papules. And now we call upon Dr. Tanvi for further presentation.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Akash, for a comprehensive description of the case. Last year, we collected 15 cases of this particular facial eruption. And we noticed that the patients had these lesions at different sides of the face, mainly the cheeks, the chin, and the jawline. On detailed clinical history, most of the patients were able to give us the history that they used to rest their face against their palm in a particular posture sometimes for several hours of a day, sometimes for long years, so that as we can see, depending on the posture, the patients develop these lesions at exactly those sites where there was friction between the skin and the palm. However, the morphology of the lesions remained constant in all the patients. It mainly consisted of multiple tiny keratotic follicular papules with a slight background hyperpigmentation, and the correlation with the position can be seen. Some of the patients also had additional papules in the form of open comedones as well as milia-like papules. Some other patients had similar papules. So depending on where the patient kept the hand against the face, they developed these papules. Sometimes they even pushed their cheek against their palm, and then they developed these lesions just adjacent to the mustache area. So we collected 15 cases. The age group was between 10 to 59 years. 10 of them were males and 5 were females. The duration was from 2 months to 20 years. This facial eruption mostly occurred over cheeks in 9 out of 15 patients. In 7 of them, the eruption was unilateral. It was mostly on the left cheek, because while they would do their hand with their right hand, they would rest their left cheek on the palm and then do the work with the right dominant hand. Others had involvement of the chin and jawline. Around 50% of the patients were atopic. So when we probed, when we took detailed history, we were able to elicit the posture in most of the patients, that is 13 out of 15, that led to inadvertent pressure. The activities were of routine, like studying, reading books, reading newspapers, correcting assignments, watching television, and general posture while conversing. We performed dermoscopy in 4 patients. It is a tool that enhances magnification by a factor of 10. We made some observations. We noticed multiple coiled hairs. In the background, we could find varying shades of brown pigmentation, and in the periphery, mild erythema. We performed a biopsy in 2 cases, which consisted of mild irregular acanthosis, follicular plugging, but none of the features were diagnostic. All the patients were advised to stop resting their face on their hand. They were advised to apply topical tretinoin cream 0.05% at night. 3 patients had comedones and they were removed. 8 out of 15 patients had a good compliance. They had significant improvement within 1 to 6 months. 1 of the patients was incompliant and had only slight improvement. 2 patients, interestingly, only avoided the posture. They were not compliant with application of the retinoic acid cream, but these 2 patients also improved. 4 patients lost to follow-up. This patient had significant improvement in 6 months after treatment. This lady had follicular papules over the jawline and had almost complete resolution within 3 months. Similarly, improvement over the chin. And this particular boy was preparing for his exams, and he developed these lesions for the past 6 months. And within 4 months of treatment, he noticed significant improvement. On review of literature, we found that similar case series had been described in 1979 as traumatic anserine folliculosis. The authors described this child who developed similar keratotic papules over the chin because of rubbing of the chin against the knees while he was watching television. They had 11 cases, mostly of the age group of 6 to 21 years. The localization was on chin, jaws, and neck, and the responsible habitude was recognized in most of the patients. Subsequently, few other authors also described this entity under different nomenclatures. These are 2 brothers who had similar lesions over the chin, described as familial keratotic papular lesions on the chin. The authors were not able to establish correlation between any posture or activity. However, we do think that it is a similar eruption. Some more examples. and this on the chin with those additional milia-like papules have also been described. So certainly prolonged pressure on the skin leads to grouped follicular papules. They are present exclusively on the portion of the face that rests against the palm, and they get resolved when the posture is changed. Because the patients rested their face in slightly different ways, so the location of the papules was also different. However, the distribution of the papules always corresponded exactly to the site of contact with the palm. This is not an uncommon entity, and it is highly responsive to treatment. Dermatology literature describes n number of pressure-induced dermatoses. We will describe a few of them briefly. Piezogenic pedal papules occurs in patients who are involved in occupations that has weight bearing for prolonged hours or for athletes such as marathon runners. It presents as firm yellowish papules on bilateral heels, mainly protruding on the medial, lateral and posterior border of the heel, which get prominent when the patient puts the foot on the ground, that is in the weight bearing position, and they become almost resolved when the patient lifts the foot off the ground. Piezogenic pedal papules. Rare sign or the Namaz sign is another frequently seen entity where the patients develop localized thickening of the skin with hyperpigmentation at the sites which rub against the ground during prayer. These are mainly forehead, knees, ankles and bilateral elbows, as can be seen here. In cases of amputation, the stump tends to develop multiple keratotic papules over time because of friction. Fiddler's neck is another entity where patients develop similar lesions as in our cases, mainly over the lateral aspect of the neck or the undersurface of the chin, because the musicians keep the instrument against the neck and the chin. Acanthoma fissuratum is another condition that is seen in few cases because of the chronic friction between the skin and the frame of the spectacles that leads to erythema, erosions, fissuring and sometimes scarring. We saw an interesting case of localized skin thickening over the ear pinna because of the friction produced by the Ryle's tube that was in situ for 6 months. Sometimes when the patients use crutches for long time, they tend to develop callus formation over the heel of the palm, which can be as massive as that seen in the picture. In patients with deformed feet, there is uneven distribution of the weight. Because of this exaggerated pressure at the lateral border, the skin tends to develop thickness and callosity-like changes. In boxers, because of chronic friction over the knuckles, they tend to develop localized thickening of the skin as well as development of these erythematous to skin-colored papules. Russell sign is described in patients of bulimia nervosa. These patients make repeated attempts to induce vomiting by inserting fingers inside the mouth, which leads to pressure of the teeth against the skin. It can be seen as pressure marks on the knuckles, as well as chronic changes like erythema, erosions, scarring. It is almost a telltale sign of bulimia nervosa. Frictional sweat dermatitis is an entity that is mainly seen during summers. It is a striking pattern of dermatitis that is seen to occur on the skin, and it is localized beneath the undergarment. It occurs because of friction and sweat during summers. Vitiligo is the disease that is commonly known to be triggered with trauma. Here, because of chronic friction between the skin and strap of the undergarment, the patient developed these depigmented macules. Urticaria is another condition. Some patients develop pressure urticaria at sites where there is exaggerated pressure, as here it can be seen along the waistline because of the tight elastic bandage of the undergarments. Sometimes patients develop these urticaria over legs because of the elastic of the socks. It can develop anywhere wherever there is exaggerated pressure. Neonatal occipital alopecia is a very common entity. It can be seen as a band-like alopecia over the occiput, It occurs because of the friction between the scalp and the bed because of the sleeping position of the neonate. And finally, in the current pandemic of COVID-19, we are witnessing an epidemic of pressure-induced skin changes in healthcare workers. These are mainly pressure marks caused by tightly worn masks, mainly at the edges of the mask and behind the ear because of the loops of the mask. Sometimes it can be as severe as erythema and erosions over the nasal bridge. And sometimes it also leads to post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. Our resident doctors and healthcare workers are also witnessing similar complaints. Because of wearing of the face mask and on top of that goggles, there is exaggerated pressure over the nasal bridge that leads to erythema, superficial erosions, deep erosions. Some patients also develop these follicular, yellowish, pustular papules. These pictures belong to, yes sir, these are of AIIMS residents. Some of them also develop scarring over the forehead because of the intense pressure caused by tightly worn goggles. The frame of the goggles caused these erosions, which led to scarring. So the list of pressure-induced dermatosis is endless. All we need is awareness, observation, and correlation, because prevention of the causative habit or the activity or the posture leads to resolution of these dermatoses mostly. Thank you so much.
Okay. Now, for me, this was something that has all the four elements that you want in a good clinical puzzle. One is it mystifies you when you first see it. Second is that when you're told what the answer is, you know, it is like, okay, you get that aha moment. Yes, you can make out that there is indeed a connection in this case between posture and the papule. The third thing I think which a good clinical mystery or puzzle should have is that it should be something you should see, you know, fairly frequently. If it's something very rare, a genetic syndrome which you see one in 10 to 12 years, then knowing it is not that great. And the fourth element, I think, is if you have a treatment for it and a simple treatment, then, you know, the loop is complete and makes it a great thing to learn. And of course, the fifth one, you know, I wondered whether I should mention this or not, but it really does contribute a bit to enjoying the puzzle, is that others should not know about it. You should be among a few who know about it so you can tell other people about it. So I hope you enjoyed our presentation of this problem. We are very happy, Dr. Khan, we will happy to answer any questions you have. And can we see if there are any questions on YouTube? Any questions on chat? Yes.
Absence of this does not mean that you are not pain.
Absolutely.
Right.
So, sir, from our limited experience of 15 patients, the duration was from 2 months to 20 years. One of the professors that was mentioned in the Alba Index case, he had it for 20 years and it was unrecognized. He had visited multiple dermatologists, and when we told the patient that the posture could be a cause, he readily accepted it and he strictly avoided the posture, resulting in almost complete resolution. So 2 months to 20 years.
No, so that's the total duration. But Dr. Khadkavat wants to know, how long can he keep it like this without getting the papule?
No, sir, he used to keep it, I mean, most of the patients used to keep it for several hours of the day. So,
if your thinking is limited, you're okay.
Yesterday, I've seen some of our faculty members considered some other illness when we were examining. Found out that on lower spine, there was a similar kind of hyperpigmentation. So, asked him what's likely. Then he said because he's lying down in bed and most of the time he is in leaning position and he attends all these online classes because of friction with the wall. This pigment might be. So we were thinking whether it will lead to pigmentation or not. So we were not sure, also asked him to take the dermatology consultation. Now
Yeah, it's likely, but I think a dermatology consultation is still a good idea. Yeah, please come. Yeah,
you don't use a mic.
Okay.
So you said about mentioned the five things which make a good clinical hazard. I want to add one more.
Right.
The best peak you get is when the patient comes after having consulted four people, having been advised 10 investigations, right. And you say go home, do nothing, and it becomes okay.
Yeah,
sure. That's probably the biggest peak you get.
Right.
So, agreed. I mean, a brilliant presentation, of course, but I just want to point out something in terms of the presentation. The slide where you showed before and after, the degree of exposure of those two pictures was slightly different. So although there was no doubt that there was improvement, if you show a before and after on pictures, you must make sure that the exposure of the photograph is also the same. Otherwise, there is a bit of confusion whether it's a true improvement or because of a difference in the exposure.
Yeah, thanks for pointing that out. We are very sensitive to that,
sure,
particularly as dermatologists. And as editors or reviewers of papers, we always point that out if the pre and post pictures. So it's good to know that sometimes we make the mistakes that we find in other people. Okay. So there are some questions on chat. If we'll start taking those, if there are none in the room, are there any other questions here? So Tanvi, the first question is, it's actually Dr. Anita saying, congratulations for discussing a common problem. Any risk factors for this condition? This is from Dr. Vishal Gupta from our own department. Why do only some individuals develop it? Is skin type important and time and degree of pressure? Time and degree of pressure you've talked about in response to Dr. Khatawat's question, but are there any other risk factors that you know about?
So 50%, almost 50% of our cases were atopic. In another case series that was described in 1979, in that also, around 60% children were atopic. So we really do not know the other risk factors, but we can look at whether atopic tendency can be a risk factor or not. However, all atopics do not develop it. So we can't say it for sure.
Okay.
Why do only some individuals develop it and skin type? So the various cases that have been collected so far globally belong to various skin types. So I'm not sure whether it is particularly limited to skin type 4 and 5 as we see in Indian patients, but yes, it is definitely worth to look at in the further studies.
Okay.
Then the expect that it would be more common in skin type 1
and 2? Actually, sir,
we don't think so. There's no reason to believe that. Yeah.
The only difference in skin types 4 and 5 is that they have a greater tendency to pigment. So they tend to develop darker lesions as compared to the lighter skin types.
Yes.
Not particularly, ma'am. It is mostly related to the number of hours any gender individual spends in that particular posture.
We had both men and women. 10 men and...
So in this case series, there were twice the number of males as compared to females, 10 males and 5 females.
Another question is, does this condition require contact of two body surfaces, mostly hands and other body parts?
So it definitely requires friction between the area which is developing the dermatosis, and mostly it is in contact with the other part of the body. However, as we discussed other dermatoses where we have seen friction of the skin with exogenous materials, then different other types of dermatoses are already described.
Okay, you answered his follow-up question, which was, can it happen with repeated contact with any inanimate object? So you answered that. Now the other question is it site specific or can it happen anywhere on the skin where there is pressure or cohesion? That again you answered by showing a lot of other conditions where can it happen due to wrist watches?
Why not? But I have not seen any case till now, yes.
So Dr. Taranjit Kaur says that this piece of information has an important role in the field of forensics. We did not know that it would, so it's good to know that. Is removal of friction or contact enough, or local application of ointment is a must? That's a good question.
So that's a very nice question. Why? Because our management consisted of two things. First and most important was avoidance of the posture. And second was application of topical retinoid acid cream. Most of the patients adhered to both the instructions. However, there were two patients who did not apply retinoic acid cream, but they strictly avoided the posture. Even those two patients had tremendous amount of resolution of the lesions. So yes, the main point is to stop the posture. Yes.
Why does it appear over night where there is continuous friction with the gold chain or whatever ornament? That continues to fall.
So,
religiously, people do not take them out.
They don't.
We hardly see such a hyperpigmentation in neck.
Yeah, I think. Right, there's a and which is not due to acanthosis is not, yeah. So I think, you know, between this, where there's gravity pulling down on your face, putting it against your palm, and a thin strand on your neck, I think there might be a little bit. It might have to do with how much pressure, over how much area.
Pressure is more important component than contact.
Yeah. This is not contact. It doesn't have. You don't need to develop an allergy to the substance that is against your skin in order to get this. It's just pressure, friction, we think.
I would like to add, I saw one case report where thickening of the skin was reported behind the ears in a lady who used to wear gold earrings with ear loops. So because of chronic rubbing with the ear loops, she did develop thickening of the skin. But there are few reports only.
So I agree with the next two comments. Well presented, Tanvi and Akash. Thank you very much for your attention.